has more than 20 years of experience as an economist in the public and private sector, both in Canada and internationally. Before joining Alberta Central, he was senior investment strategist at Lombard Odier, investment manager in London, advising investors and portfolio managers on global financial markets. Before that, he was senior economist and FX strategist at Nomura International in New York and London. Charles was at the Department of Finance in Ottawa during the global financial crisis, where he advised senior officials on economic policy to respond to the crisis. He also worked for the Bank of Canada and Morgan Stanley. Charles holds a Master of Science in Economics from Université du Québec à Montréal, and we welcome Charles.
Thank you very much for the introduction, Salman, and good evening, everyone, and thank you for having me here tonight. As was explained, I'm here to give a quick overview of what's happening in the economy in general in Canada, in Alberta, but also with a focus on what matters here for the region of Bonnie Lake and Bonnieville and Cold Lake. Next slide, please. Okay, so it's hard to discuss the economic outlook or what's happening in the economy without referencing inflation. So inflation in Canada reached level earlier this year that we hadn't seen since the early 80s. There's different reasons for that, but it's really a big shock, especially after 20 years of inflation running away between 2% and 3%. So if we go on the next slide, please. So there's different factors and Canada was not the only country who actually lived through the high inflation period. So if we look here, the blue bar is actually Canada. We have inflation rate about close to 6% at the moment, but a lot of other countries in the world. So when we hear a lot of commentators saying, oh, inflation is high in Canada because there was too much support for during COVID, there was too much, or interest rates were too low for too long. Well, it's hard to justify how inflation is high around the globe. I don't know anyone in the United Kingdom who receives CERB, yet inflation is 10%. I don't know anyone in Australia who could borrow to buy a house at the Bank of Canada rate. Yet again, inflation is more than 10% there. So there was a lot of global factors that generated inflation in 2022, and we need to take that into account. Next slide, please. So some of the factors that have influenced inflation, one is we have to take into account there was massive disruption to the supply chain. I don't know if any one of you have tried to buy a car over the past year, but I did in June. And it was interesting to go to various dealer and being told that, yeah, you can order it now. If you get it for Christmas, you're lucky. And that kind of generated a lot of inflation because suddenly, well, you need a car now. Well, you need to go and find a used car, driving up demand, driving up price. But then add that to a lot of other sectors. You've had that from bicycles in the first summer of the pandemic. You had also to deal with another way of disruptions. Transportation costs actually increased more than 10 times in 2021. To give an example, just shipping a 40-foot container between China to the port of Vancouver, which normally cost $2,000, was $20,000 for the same container. So if you're a company, you cannot absorb those costs. And that doesn't include even the delay. It was taking 6-8 weeks extra to offload that container. So it generated massive shortage around the globe in manufacturing and various sectors, and that shortage just drove price. Second big shock, we had a massive energy shock over the past year. Considering the economy here in the region, I don't have to tell you how high the oil price went, but the increase was one of the biggest increase since the oil shock of the 1970s. And when we look at gasoline prices, which is one of the big component or one of the most volatile component of CPI, well, we had the biggest increase in gasoline prices that we've ever seen in Canada's history. Again, if you're a business in Canada, everything you consume is actually transported, either by trucks, by trains. If the cost of fuel suddenly triple, quadruple, you don't have a choice as a company to pass those costs. So again, further increase. Then, of course, there was a rebound in demand. Those who had money to spend started to spend on goods, creating further shortages, also obviously held by the government support that had to be there when suddenly overnight you have the unemployment rate in Canada going from 6% to 15% in the space of 2 months, and having more than a million job losses. There is something that needs to be done. But all that kind of combined pushed inflation higher. Next slide, please. And one of the big concerns that has been is that, and that's the main concern for the Bank of Canada right now, is that it's how broad those pressures are. So the chart is showing in red is the percentage of component of CPI that are growing at more than 3%. So we're about at 75%, 3 out of 4 are growing at more than 3%. 3% being the upper range of the Bank of Canada target. So for a quick reminder, the Bank of Canada's mission is to keep inflation between 1% and 3%. So there's still a long way to go. And there's still about 65% of those components that are growing at more than 5%, so way above. So that explained why the Bank of Canada has been so aggressive increasing rates over the past year. But there are some good news. If we see at the next slide, we're seeing a deceleration. So the blue bars are the year-on-year change in prices. That's what we call inflation. So it's how much prices are changing now compared to 12 months ago. But when we look at the momentum, so how price have they reacted over the past 3 months, we're about roughly in line with what the Bank of Canada would like to see. So basically, if prices will continue to increase at the same pace we're seeing right now, we would have actually inflation around 3% or so. There's still some issues. Obviously, food prices is a complete different animals. Food prices are still increasing at 10% for various reasons, part of it being also the transportation costs that have increased a lot over the past year. But there are some good news on that front. And that's why, if we turn on the next slide, after increasing interest rates very sharply over the past year, so we started the year with the Bank of Canada policy rate at 0.25%, one of its lowest level in the history, to 4.5%, level we haven't seen since the global financial crisis in 2008. So that's a big shock on the system. But the good news is that with inflation slowing, with some signs that we actually are finally seeing inflation breaking and coming back to the target, the Bank of Canada might be done increasing rates. There's still some risk. As I said, there's still a lot of components that are growing fast. The question is how easy it will be to bring, over the next few months to bring inflation closer to 4%. It's bringing it down to 3% and to 2%. That might be where it will be a bit harder, but we'll see as we get into the summer how persistent inflation is. So if we go on the next slide, obviously having such big increase in interest rates, the first casualty has been the housing market. So in Canada, we've seen housing activity declining sharply, but Alberta and our region here, which the data only shows for the greater Fort McMurray area and Lloydminster, we're kind of in between. So that's why I've put the both of them. So activities has been slowing massively because, well, 425 basis points increase in interest rate change a lot affordability. But compared to other areas of Canada, if you think, for example, of Toronto, where, well, suddenly the average family in Toronto has to face about $40,000 extra in cost just for interest because of the increase in interest rates. So that's what's generating the correction in those areas. Here we're seeing it. We're seeing slower pace of transaction. We're also seeing some decline in prices. But again, it's nothing that is worse than we've seen elsewhere. If we look at Alberta as a whole, I'm showing Calgary as a reference that the problem with the provincial data is that it's being distorted by the market in Calgary, which has been remaining extremely strong. We haven't seen prices decline yet in Calgary, which they're still increasing. It's the only market in Canada where prices have not yet peaked. Next slide, please. So one of the challenges that we have over the next year, and that's why we have had such a big fear of recession as we were ending 2022 and starting the year, is that households have been hit in 2022 by two fronts. On one side, inflation has been much higher than wage growth, generating a decline in purchasing power. So the slide on the right is showing disposable income, which take into account your the government transfer, how it has been increasing relative to its normal or its pre-pandemic trend, and we're well below trend. We're probably about 8% or so below trend. So it means that households, on average, are probably feeling the pinch on their budget. So with that, they will need to readjust their spending, reduce their discretionary spending to switch towards essentials that are getting more and more expensive, especially, like I mentioned, food. But on the flip side, Canadians on average are extremely leveraged. We owe, as a whole, about $1.80 per dollars we earn. So that's one of the highest level debt level for household in Canadian history, but also when we compare ourselves to a lot of other developed economy, it's actually on par what we saw in countries like Spain and Ireland before they had their own financial crisis in the early 2010. So there are massive vulnerability there and some concern. And carrying so much debt as interest rates are increasing, we'll see the debt service ratio of many households increasing again, putting further strain on their budget, having to rebalance their spending towards debt repayment and reducing their capacity to spend. So that's where, as economists, we're seeing most of the drag in 2022 and 2023 happening. But so far, we're not seeing that drag. It's still holding up very well. If we go on the next slide, what we're seeing, and that's the big reason, is that the labor market is rock solid. Alberta created massive amount of job. Employment has increased by about 3-4% last year. The region here, same, that's the blue bar, that's actually the result for the greater economic region of Wood Buffalo Cold Lake. So great increase in employment. We also have seen decline in unemployment rate. Actually, the unemployment rate in Canada is at 5%, close to its all-time record. Here in the region, it's even lower than that. So with so many people being employed, there's still a lot of flexibility for the average household to manage the negative shock that they're seeing. So we're not yet, as I said, seeing all the full negative impact, and it's kind of suggesting that maybe actually the economy will stay stronger than initially expected. Next slide, please. So now I'll turn a bit more to what's happening in the region, and in some ways something I've kind of dubbed in a very cheeky way, where's the boom? It's that if we look at 2022, it has been an amazing year for the oil sector. And actually, if we look at those two charts, so the chart on the right is my estimates of what is the value of oil that's being produced in Alberta. We've averaged about $11 billion a month in oil production in the province in 2022. That's 75% higher than the previous peak in 2014 during the biggest boom. And it came from both continued increase in production, but also the big shock in prices coming post Russian invasion of Ukraine. But you look at those numbers and you're like, well, if we have such a big rebound in revenues, if oil companies are swimming in cash, why is the economy doesn't feel as good as it was in 2013 or 2014 during the previous peak? So if we go on the next slide, please. There's two reasons, there's one big reason. A bigger share of those revenues are actually not staying in the province. On one side, oil companies are sending a lot more of those revenues to their shareholders in dividend and share buybacks. So back in the peak in 2014, it was about 4% of revenues. We're now about at 8% or so of those revenues being sent back to shareholders. And then on the flip side, a smaller share of those revenues are actually reinvested in their local production. So back again, 2014, 25% of the revenues were reinvested. Now it's a meager 7%. So yes, 7% of a big amount is a big size, but you would expect, considering the amount of revenues and profit, that there should be more investment, or that at least we would see more. But I think what's happening is the oil industry may have changed permanently for good since 2015. So if we go on the next slide, and a big reason is those two charts. So on the right and on the left-hand side, that is actually forecast oil demand from various institutes in the world, considering what is being announced now in terms of global policy for decarbonization and energy transition. On the right-hand side, that's actually what's needed if we want to attain a net zero economy globally by 2050. So in the context of declining oil demand, it makes sense for oil companies to be careful and not expand production too much, especially considering the economics behind big expansion in production. So if we go on the next slide, please. So there's the big difference is that origin in 2014, the investment was, let's bring new project, let's bring new production. And those were having much bigger spillover impact on the economy, because you create, and I don't have to tell you that, but if you build, because you all know probably the economics of it better than I do, but when you start a new oil sand project, for example, it requires vast amount of money initially. Estimates are between $40 and $50 billion, and you need to hire a lot of workers with massive spillovers on construction, manufacturing, and others. Now the name of the game is changing dramatically for the oil companies. They're no longer into the game of expanding their production, because the problem is if you put in place new assets for 40, 50 billions, and in 15, 20 years from now, they're no longer needed, that's a stranded asset for your company and you're making a direct loss. So the economics are changing, and that's what you hear from all the oil executives in Calgary, is that the name of the game is now efficiency gain. Can we produce at lower cost? Can we extract more barrel from the same projects at an increased productivity? And most importantly, can we lower our carbon footprint? And that's where the region here has a lot to gain from. Next slide, please. And we're already seeing some of the impact of the lack of investment that we've seen since the peak of 2014. So there's about 85,000 jobs less in the broader oil industry, if you include from the extraction to the construction to the manufacturers to the engineers working in the industry. And that has been replaced. We've seen gains, and that's despite the whole province as a net increasing their employment by 140,000 employment or jobs since the beginning. But as I said, so, and because of that lack of investment, we're also seeing something that we're not expecting at some point, is that we're seeing wage also converging between Alberta and the rest of Canada. Is that at the peak in 2014, we had a wage advantage of about 15% or so in Alberta, and now it's about 5%. So it might not sound rosy, but that's actually a changing economy, but there are some better days coming up. So if we go to next. So one of the things that we have to take into account, and that's where the region here will be benefiting a lot, is that we are at the eve of a green boom. Like I explained, oil companies are to guarantee their survival, to guarantee that they'll be the last producer standing, they are gradually, they need to reduce their emissions per barrel. And that's where carbon capture is coming to be, will be the big game changer on their front. And that will be generating a lot of investment, especially in the region here, with a lot of the sequestration happening in the region here. To give a quick estimate, it's estimated that about, in Canada as a whole, we'll need about $2 trillion of investment over the next 30 years to reach our net zero objective. Well, if we can, that about a quarter of our carbon emission are from the energy sector. Well, about a quarter of that money should be going towards energy. That means about $500 billion in investment over the next few years. There's big money coming. I think the question is, are we ready to put it in place? Because that will be our next investment boom here. That will be what will be generating the economic revival or a new economic boom in the region and having dramatic spillover on other industry from construction to manufacturers to retail. So, and that's, I think the, I would like to leave you with is that, yes, it has been probably a very hard 8 years or so since 2015 for most of the region and for Alberta in general, but the future is actually bright. We just need to attract those dollars and of any of all regions. I think the region here of Bonnyville and Cold Lake is very well placed to take advantage of that new green boom. So I'll leave it here. Yeah.